But more generally speaking, I'm going to talk about security issues in with CiviCRM. Why should we talk about security issues? Generally speaking, the complexity of the systems we use have been increasing, right? Over the last years, and it's not slowing down. So our systems are getting more and more complex, and it's the more complex a system is, the more likely it is that there's flaws in the system, vulnerabilities, and the fact that you have it in the internet, on the internet, your system, makes it a very convenient way of harming your organization by basically doing a cyber attack. Sounds very weird, but basically just attacking your system in the sense of getting data, manipulating your system, all sorts of way where somebody can harm you from the other end of the world, basically. Just to give an idea of what harm means, basically, if you have a security flaw that allows somebody to access your database and they can run away with it, they can sort of get your data. It doesn't sound bad, but it's pretty easy to take this data, create a scam email in your name saying, why don't you donate money to us, to another bank account that's not yours, right? And you're gonna have very upset donors, and you're gonna lose your credibility as an organization, and that's something that can happen very, very easily, and that's just one thing that can happen to you if you don't sort of pay a little bit attention to your IT security. What we also have is mass surveillance on a huge scale, state-funded, as we've seen by the Snowden revelations. It's not something that all organizations have to care about, but you have to keep in mind some organizations are trying to protect freedom of democracy, stuff like that, and they basically, depending on, I'm not talking about your state in particular, but every state does it, right? At the end of the day, it's not really what you want is that people support you for democracy, that this data, the information about these people and in what way they're sort of interacting with you is out there. And once it's out there, for example, we know that NSA is collecting loads of these kind of these data. And even if they're not using it for bad, which we don't know, but assuming they don't, it's still fairly likely that this data is leaked at some point, right? So as soon as the data exists, you have a problem, because then these people have to make sure that they don't have any flaws in their security either. And what's worse is that tools to actually exploit these kind of vulnerabilities that you have in your system are super easy. You can just download it basically, anyone can do it, and then just start looking for vulnerabilities on the internet and exploit them more or less automatically. So basically, everyone can do it. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about is how these security threats look and how to tackle them. And then I'm going to give you a brief live demo and some discussion at the end. Don't be scared, I don't want to go into detail, but what I want to show with this sort of architecture stack of CiviCRM is that we have a lot of different layers here. Only the one at the top is CiviCRM, right? But it relies on a bunch of other components, which adds to the complexity of the system that I was talking about earlier. And the more complex the system is, the more likely is that there's vulnerabilities in there. So what we're doing usually when you think of your Civi installation is you wrap it in a neat little web server, and you think about it as the CB, right? But internally it still has all these different layers. Why you do that is because you want your Civi to interact, right? You send out members to newsletter to your members or to your subscribers. You get feedback as the click-through rates and whether they opened the newsletter or not. You have donation pages and all sorts of interaction with constituents out in the web. Then you have your back office. Somebody does the contact management, and they don't necessarily have to be next to the computer that actually runs CiviCRM, right? We want that to be flexible and sort of take advantage of the internet, saying you can do that from home or in all the three different offices I have. Management takes stats, and this is another important one. Is you want to be able to exchange data with other systems. A lot of the cases, it could be accounting, but it could also be an external website running, like some campaigns for you, and you want to integrate that data into your constituent database. And as I already mentioned, what has to happen here is that we connect our system to the internet, so it's accessible basically from anywhere. Which means that now that it's on the internet, all these people can access the system from wherever they are in the world. But which also means that there might be bad people, and those people can access the system as well. Yes, you have your username, password, and so on, but that doesn't apply to vulnerabilities, i.e. faults or flaws in the system to circumvent these kind of login procedures. And what's worse is, this symbolizes a fully automatic attack, right? Since we're in this world of computers, anything you can do manually, basically, you can automate, right? So you can have, and there's people doing that, as soon as there's a flaw uncovered for a certain system, for example, for CiviCRM, it's not as interesting to target CiviCRM yet because we don't have as many installation. But like Drupal is a very widely used base for websites. So as soon as there's a Drupal flaw discovered, people set up servers that scan the internet for this flaw, and just fully automatically break into your system and get your data, right? There's also, as I mentioned, basically law offices, secret services, that do that on a wide scale. And as I mentioned again, right, we're not necessarily talking about your government, but every other government on the planet does that. And last but not least, it's called, they're sort of called script kiddies, but basically people that can just download exploit, like a little program that knows how to exploit a certain flaw in your program and just play with it and maybe just try to annoy you, but it's still something that you wouldn't want, right? Because that gives people with very little knowledge in the subject a great power to destroy systems. So again, back to the system view. And what I want to show is that this various exploits on all, actually on each level of system we're using. We had a couple of security flaws for CiviCRM in particular, but just as well, we had some flaws in Drupal that were very, very severe. We had some flaws in PHP, although these components further down are more widely used and more frequently updated and more, they're very old, so they're kind of in the clear, but the further you go up in the stack, the more likely you have problems. And then sometimes at the very bottom, like the shell shock or the heartbleed bugs of the recent years have exposed. Sometimes you have problems that people without any, access credentials or anything can access your server, right? I know it looks a bit like a conception picture, but it should be something like the opposite. So the standard approach to this is to put your installation into a virtual private network. That means it doesn't have to be, so a private network would be like within the room, for example, and everybody's connected to our computer, we can all work on it, right? In this case, back office and management. Virtual private network sort of extends this to the internet in the sense that you need a certain encryption software to get into this virtual software, into this virtual network. But essentially, it's the same. It's like only a selected number of people can access this network, which essentially leaves all these guys out, right? I'm not going to go into detail on how to potentially break this, but essentially, this is what you want, right? You want to lock it away, so whatever happens out there is not going to get to it. But obviously, that locks out all the other people as well. You really don't want to lock out your donors or your members or other system you want to exchange data with. So the standard approach is an application firewall, it's called. Basically, what it does is it sort of accepts incoming traffic requests from all over the internet, but only if they comply with certain criteria, right? For example, it's okay for anyone to access a donation page, right? Because that's what we want. But you have to set it up in a way that it can't, that it's hard to exploit this with one of the security flaws that are out there. So this standard approach is what I said, it just filters the incoming, the requests people do. Basically, if you sort of start, click on a link for a donation page, your browser does is send off a request, and you get back the donation page, and you can fill out the data and so on. What you want to do is filter this traffic in the sense that it's only allowed for donation pages to be accessed. It's not allowed for any backend pages, for example. Especially you need to make sure that these rules, or like the idea is that you have the rules set up in a way that it also filters out sort of malicious kind of requests. What you do in order to sort of tell this firewall which of the requests are okay or which aren't, you have to define a set of rules. There's a lot of options out there for this kind of firewall. This is a sort of well-established technology. But in this case, in the case of CV, which is kind of a complex interaction between the donor and the system, which even gets worse now with the more interactive pages with Angular and so on, you have to be very careful in the crafting of these rules, because what you want is to make these rules as precise as possible in order to lock out any sort of malicious requests. But on the other hand, if you want to do this, you end up with a huge zoo of rules that are really hard to maintain. So there's a trade-off here. The more time and detail you invest to sort of get these rules perfect, the more rules you're going to end up with, and that's really hard to maintain. So there's a trade-off, and we can see a tendency that these rules tend to be too lax, because if you have the rules too strict, you're going to lock out donors, which on the other hand will cost you money and will also cost you, well, sort of the kind of nice feeling people have when they go on your website and all of a sudden stuff doesn't work anymore. That's not what we want, right? So we tend to make these rules too lax. What I want to present now is an alternative to this standard approach, which is an extra server sitting somewhere out in the internet and has a sort of privileged connection to your system. But this server will be the primary point of entry for any kind of requests, right? So if somebody goes to your donation page, it will end up on the server, and the server decides whether this is a malicious request or not. That's the idea. The mission is, we want a proxy that is designed for CiviCRM. And the idea behind that is that the amount of rules you need for the other system to work properly is based in the way they work, because they don't know how Civi works and how the requests are structured. They just have to sort of look at every request in a kind of unknowing kind of from a kind of unknowing point of view and just decide based on these rules. But if you understand how requests are structured and how the process is supposed to be, it should be way easier to configure this, right? This is the idea. So we have a system that knows CiviCRM and takes it from there. And it should be simple in the sense of it should be simple to maintain, because that's sort of the second degree security flaw, is if your security system is too complex to maintain. What we also wanted is whitelisting instead of blacklisting, meaning this one approach is blacklisting to say I define rules of how a malicious request looks like, but that has the disadvantage that you have to know the kind of malicious requests that are out there. And usually, if somebody knows, then we can also just fix the problem. The other idea, the other sort of approach, is whitelisting, saying I can specify all the requests that are allowed, and everything that doesn't match this pattern, we're just going to throw out because it's not what we want. And this is usually whitelisting is a lot more difficult, and you, as I said, you end up with the huge amount of rules. What we also wanted is parameter sanitation. Is a bit too much into detail, but basically some of the security flaws is that if you submit like a name and you sort of put special characters in the name, or like sort of sneak data you don't want, that usually doesn't go into the in the name, into this name that's transmitted to the system, that you can get it to break at some point. So what you want to do is you look at the parameters you get, like names and account numbers and whatnot, and make sure that it's actually just an account number or a name. And again, this is something that's very specific to Civi. It's not something it will cost you more effort to replicate this in this kind of more general firewall approach. And as a last point, we just want to add sort of features. It's the same as the whitelisting. We want to decide what parts of the system, what kind of functionality we want to expose to the world. What it is a very, it's a handful of PHP scripts, very simple. And you can just take them and upload them on any kind of web server that hosts like easy websites and stuff like that. I'll get to that in a minute. But it's important that you, in order to have this external server, you don't want, you don't want a server that you have to maintain yourself, right? So the idea is, with an easy set of scripts that you can just upload, you get all the sort of perks, all the advantages of just having a managed hosting somewhere. And what usually happens in managed hosting is that people have one server with hundreds of websites deployed on it, like small personal websites and stuff like that. And because there's so many clients on that server, they usually have very high security standards, right? So they would sort of react on unknown security flaws immediately. And they're usually very cheap, since they're sort of rolled out to hundreds of users. And they're usually very well connected, right? So basically you have a system there that is very potent, very, very well equipped to do what we want, which is channel all the incoming traffic through there. And what it also does, it can sort of prevent a lot of bogus or unnecessary requests to make its way to your system, slowing your system down. And since we're all Civi users, it's pretty easy to create one or two, three searches or some kind of requests that can really slow your system down. So what the system can do right now, and this is because we did this prototype version for a client of ours, they were very much focused on newsletter, because as soon as you sort of cut the system off into this private network, yes, you can still send out newsletters, but usually you have images in the newsletter. You have all these statistics, as in click-through rates, who opened my newsletter. All this kind of information is basically requests going back to your server, right? And if you want to, sort of shut your system, sort of lock your system up in this private network, you're going to lose all of this. So what we implemented is that this little proxy thing can serve the newsletter resources, i.e. like the pictures or some kind of, you know, if there's a PDF in there, stuff like that, basically stuff that you send out with the newsletter. And it has also the advantage that we can cache it on the server. So only one of the, let's say, if you send out 50,000 newsletters, basically what happens right now, if you don't have this this proxy, is that 100,000 requests will come in for each of the resources, 50,000. What did I say? So it's really easy at this point to cache it. You have to be careful of, because some of the requests are these kind of, did the user really open the email? You still want that information, but at least the graphics and stuff like that you can easily cache. We also offer the static version of the newsletter. I don't know if you've seen that. You can have a link in your newsletter saying, I want to see the static version of this newsletter because it doesn't work in my browser or something, in my email browser. And then you usually get to a CiviCRM page where the whole newsletter is represented as an HTML page. And in order for this to work, we would also have to get this this sort of channel through the to the proxy. And again, I'm mentioning all of these things individually because everything you want to expose now, you have to sort of add to the proxy, right? Or add the advantage of not allowing anything else to pass this. What we also needed to take care of is the sign-on, sign-off kind of thing that comes with the newsletter. You want to sign to get out of the newsletter group, or you want to sign on. These kind of things need to pass the proxy as well. And very important for the interaction with other systems is the API, right? We have a very straightforward, you'll see it in a minute, straightforward system to say these kind of API calls I will allow, others I won't. Exactly. So also what we want to do is flooding or denial of service filters, meaning one of the possible attacks, which is like more like a crude version of an attack, is just to bombard yourself with loads of requests. And if it's a valid request, the proxy would still sort of channel it through to your server, which in the, at the end of the day, since in the scenario that the proxy is on a system with a high bandwidth, would still sort of harm your server in the sense that it's going to slow it down until you can't use it anymore. So at this point, this is like the perfect point to implement something like an algorithm to see if somebody's trying to slow down your server by bombarding it with requests, even if it's valid requests. What it cannot do is, so we haven't, because in the scenario of our client, they have external donation pages running on a completely different server and sort of push the results into the system via the API. So our current client is perfectly happy with this. But at some point, maybe there might be a point in adding donation pages, membership pages to this whole approach. We also haven't done Drupal web forms or these self-server dashboards. So as you can see, if you have a system that's very heavy on user interaction with all the different possibilities that CiviCRM has, this is probably not a good approach right now. but if you sort of limit to certain areas of interaction with your client and you're worried about security, then I think it should be fairly simple to extend the proxy to cater for that. A bit more into detail about the mailing proxy. There's a cache in the proxy that would with a certain lifetime, so it would cache all the, let's say, images in your mailing. If you change it on the backup because you've seen that it's broken or some whatever, this is at the cost that it's got a time to live. So like it would only refresh the cached item after, let's say, 10 minutes or whatever. So it comes at the cost that changes to the images in your mailing would have a certain delay before it gets out. But since this is a mailing, you've sent it out anyway, first people have already seen it, I think that's fairly acceptable. Exactly, as I said, we're passing through the open and the click-through events, that the things that are in the mail to make you sort of generate these neat stats of how many people actually read the email. And this is an interesting part, because when CiviCRM sends out an email, then it comes with the URLs of the images you have on your server. So we have a little extension that will sort of mend the URLs to point to the proxy instead. So people, if they open the email, which will be sort of the request for the images will be redirected to the server, to the proxy. Same with the API feature. Basically, what you do is you can again, it's whitelisting, right? So you have to specify the API calls you want to allow, and you also define which kind of type of parameter you expecting, so you can filter out malicious parameters. Civi does some of this. Definitely, Tim can probably tell you more about this, or Kurun. But in the spirit of trying to catch it as early as possible, we're doing this kind of sanitation at this point. Demonstration. It's kind of hard to demonstrate this, but so I can tell you what I can show you. So I have my local installation. I don't know if you can see it. London 2015. I have a proxy for that. If you just get to the proxy, then that's what you see. Obviously, if you're another organization, you've changed the graphics. But basically, if you just go to that proxy, it'll do nothing. It'll just say, hello, I'm a proxy. I can show you the static mailing example. So So this is the static mailing on Civi. It's a stupid mailing, but nevertheless, I put in a graphic so I can show you the caching. And if you call the same mailing ID on the proxy, it'll basically show the same thing, except that this is a Well, it's kind of hard to demonstrate, but it's this image is coming straight out of the cache rather than from CiviCRM. Because if I reload this over and over and over, well, it's cached in the browser, but let's say I'm 100 different people, then it's going to be loaded again and again from CiviCRM, whereas the cache has this graphic stored inside. And can take load away from your system. I'm just going to show you the configuration file for the proxy. So what you can see on the left side, that is all there is to it. There's one library here for the caching. There's the content of the cache, which is, I think one of them is the image. I don't know what the other one is. And that's basically it. These examples you can just kick out. But basically, you can just download this thing, push it on a server, and then you all you have to do is edit this config file, put in the address of the proxy, which I put here, the address of the CiviCRM where it's supposed to go to, and most of the rest you can ignore. It's basically extra options. Here, for example, if you set these are the different sort of the five different pass-through things that we have right now. It's set to the default address where it should be sort of passed on to. If you set that to null, it's just going to turn it off, right? So if you don't want any of the features except for one, just set this to null, and then you're going to be fine. There's some debugging options. It's quite helpful since when you're setting up the system, as long as the VPN is not working properly or why doesn't requests go through, you can sort of have it logged, which obviously you should turn off once you're live. This is now the, this is not file caching options. Okay, this I should change at some point. This is basically the API keys that you need for the API pass-through. There's a key abstraction, meaning you have a mapping in there saying this API key here is in fact this API key on the server. You could just use the same ones. But in case, for example, you want to give out some extra keys and want to disable them later for other people, this is where you would do that. Same with the system, with the site keys. And you would usually not put this in here, but rather in a file called secrets, which I've done. And that's my installation. So API key is the key for my user, and this is the site key. So where was I? Config here. And at the bottom, that might be interesting, is the list of allowed API actions, which is hierarchically structured. You have the entity and the, I don't know, anyone ever worked with the API-ish? Well, you got an idea what I'm talking about, right? The API always consists of an entity, for example, contact or address or something, and then an action to do with it, in this case, get single, and then a bunch of parameters, right? So what this does is it says the only thing that we're going to allow to pass the proxy is a get single request for contacts based on email. And the email is, right now it's sanitized to be a string. Usually we would add, that wasn't the case for a client, that's why it's not here, but you would add something that would say, obviously in this email thing, we're only gonna allow emails or something like that, right? I can show you what I mean. I have a little API request that I can show you. Which is actually what you see right there. So basically I can show you a breakdown of this on my other slide. It's basically, this is the request we're talking about, contact get single based on this email address with the keys that I've sort of authorized. And this works, right? This is passed through. However, if you want to do like a get single based on ID, which you usually can, it will be rejected, right? So you can to very great detail determine which kind of API calls you want to go through your proxy relay system. To sort of finish this, I wanted to do a quick comparison between the application firewall approach and the CiviProxy approach. Most of the points we already covered. The application firewall is easily extensible, right? You can just add rules and whatever you need. Whereas the proxy comes with the predefined set of functions. You've seen it's configurable, but you can't easily sort of integrate a whole new range of features like the donation page or something. You would have to add another another feature to the proxy for that. Also, and this is especially important in the security field, is the application falls are fairly established, whereas this is a newly developed piece of software. It's fairly simple, so it shouldn't be too bad, but obviously it doesn't help if your security software has a lot of bugs itself, which I hope I don't, but it's something that's worth noting, that this is usually the more established the software is, the less crude bugs it has. As you can see, both of these items are in favor of the application firewall, but it's really hard to set up for Civi, even though I know there's kind of predefined sets for application firewalls out there, which makes it in turn easier to set up, but you still end up with the hard to maintain kind of problem. Also, if you want to, for example, if you want to add another API call to your list of allowed traffic, allowed requests, it's harder to get it done properly in the application firewall, because you have to think of all the different cases. In turn, in the proxy software, since it knows how to break down the API calls and the parameters, it's fairly easy just to extend it. Same with the input sanitation, which is the sort of control of the incoming parameters for the requests. That basically wraps it up. Questions? Remarks? So in the case of our client here, yes. So they don't have a lot of data exposed to clients. There's not a lot of membership login kind of thing. They have a donation page, as I said, which is also fairly complex, so they couldn't model that in CiviCRM anyway. And they just push the data through the API. So this is the perfect approach for them, basically. But as I said, the organizations that have a very broad approach in addressing the or sort of connecting to the to their members, it might be pretty difficult to sort of model all of these in the proxy.
So, like, if an organization was using some custom Rails app or Symfony app or Typo3 or something, they might do a small plugin there to handle the registration form, and then install the proxy.
They can just use the API, basically, right? So that's one of the ideas. Is that the most important thing for me here in this part is that it's easy to extend the API sort of pass-through settings, right? I think it's one of the safest approaches is to have your external system to do all the communication with the user and just sort of collecting the necessary data via the API from CiviCRM, and in turn, once there's a registration or whatever, just pushing it up back via the API. It's vital here that you don't store any data on the sort of external system, because then you run into the same kind of problems. But with that client of ours, it's working pretty well. So the email thing works very well. Since it's just these open close requests, it doesn't make a difference really, because as I said, we've got this on a managed hosting server, which is not at the other end of the world as your Civi installation. So there's virtually no delay. I haven't tested it with huge amounts of queries, but they have newsletters, as I said, in the 50K range, and that's okay. It actually sort of helps the system because of the all the images and stuff not being loaded from the system anymore. The API thing, if you have a very heavily interactive kind of form, that might be an issue. So what they're doing is they're querying stuff at the beginning when somebody, you know, types in their name, sort of transparently in the background, that's fine. And then the submission is asynchronously. So they just collect the data and then have a job that every half an hour pushes the data into CiviCRM. But if you have a highly interactive form that says, you know, this is you are and so on, and you load data, that might be a bit more, a bit slower. But on the other hand, I think it's comparable to the Ajax pages that in Civi that we have right now.
So the caching and so on is that kind of something you've written there, or is that using other?
The cache uses a module called Cache Lite. This one.
Interesting. You know, alternative approach would be to work from a delegated and caching proxy, sort of Varnish, and you know, work this into it that way.
Yeah, but the idea is, are you talking about the same kind of data, the images and stuff, or are you talking about user data as well? Because if you talk about user data as well, you end up with the same problem that you don't want to have them on an exposed server, basically. Maybe I didn't understand your question.
When you're talking about user data, what sort of thing you mean there?
Like caching API requests or stuff like that, or caching user data, basically, like not anonymous resources like graphics, but basically requests of any kind. If you do want to do that, and you cache them in an exposed server, then you end up with user data being on that server.
Right. Yeah. Now, I suppose looking at something like Varnish is coming very much from that. You know, its focus is as a caching proxy with all those sorts of concerns and considerations as to what it does do and doesn't, along with the performance side of things.
No, I'm pretty sure it can do that.
That's a sort of starting point in terms of that. Still to do, you know, all the sort of thing you're talking about, but.
Mm. So you want to put it in between?
You can do sort of plugins into
Haven't thought about it, honestly, but could be. So that's definitely true, right? Varnish is a very sort of reliable caching service. And I think, don't they have an application firewall kind of plugin as well?
I know you can do plugins for it.
Yeah, so I can't. But it sounds reasonable. Yeah. Any more questions?
I was thinking the scenario I've run into a couple of times is that a client wants a Drupal website with deep CiviCRM integration and web forms and logins and everything.
Yeah.
But they don't want their contact database of 200,000 people exposed on some public web server. That might actually work with this sort of construction if the CiviCRM Drupal modules and WebForm CiviCRM, etc., would make it possible to select a server of choice instead of just defaulting to the current installation.
Yeah. Well, in this, I would always opt for the API, but that usually means that you can't use all the pre-fashioned web forms and stuff connection.
That's true.
I don't know how to solve it, and actually, the two guys who know how to solve this just left the room.
Yeah. Well, how we tackled similar things to that is using the multi-site setup.
Sorry.
Using Civi multi-site.
But that still accesses the same database.
The same database, but then whether from the, so you've got the Civi side behind the firewall, as in particular VPN access, whatever, and then so the website side would use probably something like this. But from our perspective, it's just a load balancing and resource. So you use this tool from the website interaction.
But it, so your website would still need to have access to your database, meaning if somebody breaks into your website, they can still siphon off all your data.
Well, I was thinking that then integrating, yeah, they can, but this is, I'm just thinking about the proxy here. So from the website, going to the Civi, but going to the proxy, would that work?
Oh, in between the website.
So website, the proxy, then the Civi database, back end, multi-site with a Civi to VPN access.
I guess
to the
so.
Same database, but then you've got no proxy restrictions there.
I guess so. So again, if you're talking about it depends on what your site, the kind of combination communication your site has with the CiviCRM backend. If you somehow access the database directly, then no, this isn't the way to go, right? But if it's if you can make it based on the API or some kind of similar kind of HTTP requests that we can integrate into this, then yeah, that will work, I assume. But it somehow doesn't sound so. This scenario again, I think, would be rather on the application firewall kind of approach, because as I said, it's very versatile and flexible. So you can probably adjust it to your particular sort of communication structure. Again, it's going to be very difficult to maintain it, I think. But this is aiming mostly at the API and the mailing stuff right now. If you have, as I said, if you have a broad range of sort of, if you're using basically the whole range of donor, unit, or member interactions of CiviCRM, then that would be, I would say, it's too much work to integrate all of this into this approach.
So can we have like some areas of the Civi installation protected by this, but some still publicly accessible? Because we use some fairly extensive Drupal web forms, but we're also having a custom front end developed that's going to communicate with Civi using the REST API. So this looks like an interesting thing to use to restrict.
To restrict
what REST API calls can come in, but it doesn't cover the Drupal web forms. I mean, can we have, say, the REST API protected by this proxy, but the Drupal web forms still accessible to the outside world?
You could, but getting back to this problem, ideally we would want to lock this away completely, yeah. Right? So what you're doing is put the REST API, well, basically to through this thing, right? This would be the REST calls in your scenario, and you would still tear down these walls. So everybody could still access your Drupal, your Civi, and so on there,
yeah.
Right? So you're losing the protection, basically, that this offers. But yeah, you could do that. And again, if you're exposing the things, sort of, if you know exactly what you're exposing and you're sure there's no flaws, then that is an option. But usually it's a very diffuse set of queries that have to be allowed for this to work, right? So you usually end up with rules that are far too lax to actually cover any vulnerabilities.
As an extension to your question, wouldn't it be possible to have the Drupal, the public Drupal on a separate server, CiviCRM within the VPN, and when the web form communicates with the CiviCRM, then to do this communication through a web application firewall? So we have the CiviProxy, which is good for the things you talked about, and would be difficult, as I understood, to implement the web form calls. But would it be easier to set up a separate web application firewall for the web form communication, or would it be easier to to extend the CiviProxy piece of software in order to get along with the web form calls?
That depends on how exactly the Drupal web forms communicate with CiviCRM, which I don't know exactly what's happening there. If it's all API, then sure, it's perfect.
So if it's all API, then it would be possible to integrate this into
sure.
CiviProxy.
Yeah, I don't see why not. I mean, you probably need a little tweaking, but yeah.
It's still some work, I believe. But I think this would be the Königsweg in German, the golden way to do it.
So I have to take your word for it, because I was under the impression that it's not just API calls. But if that's the case, perfect. Then we can have on, let's say, this system, we can have another Drupal running. You have a bunch of web forms here, and all the API requests run through here. Perfect.
In that case, can we separate the rules? So an API called by one server would look like this, and an API called by the Drupal server will look like that?
Either that. Well, for that, you would have to extend the proxy a little bit. It has a structure. It's like a little hook where you can say, is that allowed or not? But what you can easily do is set up two of those, because it costs virtually nothing. You can even set them up alongside each other and just configure them differently. So that shouldn't be a problem. Any more questions? So what we're going to do is, once we've finished sort of rolling this out with the client, we're going to put it on GitHub. It's not there yet, but it'll be in the next month or two. That's it.